Let's use NX assembly constraints to demonstrate how to constrain a GD&T datum reference frame. I've labeled the datum features on this part using NX PMI annotation. All right, let's first fix this lower plate so it can't move. So the part we want to constrain to the table has 6 degrees of freedom. Let's constrain this lower face, datum feature A, to the upper face of the plate. Okay, when we do that, 3 degrees of freedom have been removed. I can drag the part in two directions, or I can rotate it in the plane, but I can't move it away from the plane. All right, next, let's constrain datum feature B using two pins. Now, there's a lot of different ways we could constrain datum feature B to align it up. We might, for example, align it to the side, or we might make it parallel and then at a distance. But in this case, we're going to use two constraints to say as if we're going to slide the part up against two pins. So after we do that, the part has one remaining degree of freedom, meaning that two more have been removed when we constrain datum feature B. Or lastly, let's constrain datum feature C to one point. So basically, we'll slide the part up against one more pin. The part now is fully restrained in all 6 degrees of freedom. All right, let's review the constraints in the constraint navigator to show the three datum features and see how they're constrained. So we've got our datum feature A, our datum feature B, and our datum feature C. So this is the classical case called the 3-2-1 rule. The first plane removed 3 degrees of freedom, the second line removed two, and lastly, the last point removed that last final degrees of freedom. In this second example, this power transistor has a plane of symmetry. So in this case, we'll make that one of our datum features. So in this case, we'll make that plane of symmetry, or the feature of size across the transistor, we'll use that as our datum feature B, our secondary datum. So that effectively makes the center plane of the transistor the datum plane. So let's go through this example. Again, the part originally has 6 degrees of freedom. So first we'll constrain datum feature A, the bottom face of the transistor, to the upper face of the heatsink. Okay, 3 degrees of freedom have been removed. So the part is free to move in two directions or rotate in that plane. Next, let's center datum feature B using a center constraint using the rule of two faces between two faces. So the part now has only one remaining degree of freedom, meaning that two more have been removed. Lastly, let's constrain datum feature C, the mounting hole. Let's constrain that to the screw hole using a touch align constraint. So the part now is fully restrained in all 6 degrees of freedom. Again, let's review the constraints in the constraint navigator to see how the three datum features are constrained, our A and our B and our C. So this case is really the same as the last case. The only difference is we've allowed a center plane of the part to be a datum, basically by attaching that datum feature to the feature of size instead of just a feature on the side of the part. So again, this follows the same classical 3-2-1 rule. In this third example, we constrain the revolved axis first, and the 3-2-1 rule becomes more like 4-1-1. Okay, again, the part originally has 6 degrees of freedom. Datum feature A is attached to the feature of size of the revolved feature, which makes the center line of the revolved part the datum axis. Constrain this feature to the axis of the mounting ribs. In this case, 4 degrees of freedom have been removed by constraining this axis, leaving motion along the axis and rotation. Next, let's assign datum feature B, the mounting face at the front edge of the motor, which holds the mounting plate. We'll constrain that to the rib, where the mounting plate mounts. Okay, the part now has only one remaining degree of freedom left, the rotation about the axis. So lastly, let's align datum feature C, one of the holes, to the center plane to remove this rotation. So the part now is fully constrained in all 6 degrees of freedom. Again, let's review the constraints in the constraint navigator. In this last example, a revolved feature of size is also a datum. The difference here is that with this short part, the center axis is used as a secondary datum instead of the primary. Okay, again, the part starts with 6 degrees of freedom free. Okay, datum feature A is the flat face of the snap ring. So let's constrain that face to the mating face on the shaft. So 3 degrees of freedom have been removed, leaving motion and rotation in the plane. Okay, in this case, datum feature B is attached to the cylindrical feature of size, which means the center line of the snap ring. Let's align it with the axis of the shaft. Okay, the part now has one remaining degree of freedom, or rotation, about the axis. Well, in this case, let's just leave it that way because let's not bother to constrain it, because that's the way the snap ring behaves in the real assembly. It's free to spin about that axis. So this video has demonstrated a GD&T datum reference frame approach to NX assembly constraints. Thinking about assembly constraints this way can help to properly constrain an assembly without over or under constraining it. For those not familiar with GD&T, Google the phrase datum reference frames to find out more information. Basically, a datum reference frame is usually 3 datum features that form a coordinate system to constrain a part for inspection. Some quick tips here for those learning NX. Notice that I accessed all commands using the shortcut toolbar, and I kept the ribbon collapsed to make more screen space. I also used the Escape key and Function key F5 to deselect objects and to refresh the display after showing the degrees of freedom. I used Customize to add the Show Degrees of Freedom command to the Assembly's Component shortcut toolbar. This command is also in the shortcut menu, so you can still access it with a right click, but I like to add it to the shortcut toolbar right next to Assembly Constraints and the move commands. Well, thanks for watching.